two meetings, very well attended, I think we've had to open all three conference rooms, for our staff to come and tell us what ways of working would support them. Because obviously, trying not to get political in any of this, but obviously the few challenges that everyone is facing at this minute in time, where working from home may give people an opportunity to save some money by not having travel costs, that working from home now becomes a little less if you have to pay more for heat and lighting to stay at home and work. So what looked potentially a simple option to try and put some kind of flexible way in has now become a bit of a double-edged sword. It's a very useful conversation for staff. And out of it has come a number of ways, which is probably more looking at us massively cutting and changing the way that we offer our flexi time so that people can potentially come and go. So you can come in the morning, if you're a parent, you can come in and do a shift up to about 3 o'clock, you can clock off, go collect your children, take them home, which would save you the cost to the school club or whatever else, and you can clock back in and carry on working until 7 or 8 o'clock. So giving people a breath flexibility to be able to do the job is potentially what we're talking now, as well as potentially hybrid. But a lot of work is currently going on around flexible ways to continue to support our staff. And the last one really is the driver for a lot of this, which is our workforce planning. You need to know when people may leave, and obviously with some of our firefighters, because there are triggers in relation to pensions where people may go, you can predict that. What you're not predicting at the moment is people leaving for more money or leaving to find different jobs. But you need to know, be on top of that. So there's a real piece of work being done on the flexible workforce planning to ensure that the leaders of each department know what the department needs, ensures it has some kind of succession plan, so that if you know, I know I need four professionals to cover the whole breadth of HR support this organisation. So I need to know that the four professionals I have, I have people underneath who can step up if that role needs to be done, and we are developing them to meet that need. That has to be replicated across the organisation. So we plan that way, and then we also have to plan our recruitment, because the numbers go out the doors, we need the same number of firefighters. So you fundamentally have to plan our workforce planning. So there's a big push now for not only the pod looks after workforce planning, but each individual department knows what it needs, knows the plans to development, and knows to plan people being out to work. Service. The workforce planning is a big one, big thing. And the final real success of that is modern apprentices. As you know now, all our firefighters that come in are classed as apprentices. So as an authority, it works well for us. We can fundamentally sort of subsidise our budgetary costs by using the apprenticeship levy, which has worked very, very well for us indeed. But we're now expanding it so that a lot of our support staff, financial teams, HR, ICT, a lot of the things are bringing apprentices into the organisation. It's allowing a lot of opportunity and seeing a lot of growth and a lot of new people come into this organisation and get kickstarts on, hopefully, they stay and stay in this great place to work. But that's a lot of work that we have to do to train all the staff. So, really, a whistle stop tour, I did say to the deck that it may be, but I know there's more questions than answers I can give this afternoon. If there's something Scrutiny Committee think you'd rather hone down on a particular piece of work, I'm happy to come and speak to you about that as well. But as a whistle stop tour, any questions?
Yeah, thanks for that question.
Thanks, Chair. I raised this a couple of years ago, actually. There's been tremendous success in recruiting more women firefighters and more men firefighters, but within those statistics, men women tend to fall through the gap, and we've not been quite successful in the past with that group. Has there been any improvement, or has there work been done on that?
I think it's all to the cases of pulling together. The network's now becoming far more crucial to supporting us, and then finding those ways of attraction and bringing people into the organisation. I think, as with a lot of the challenges with recruitment, the broad brush is people have got to work for us, and come in, and it poses some of the challenges to take in a different direction, but the representative of AIM staff and support jobs isn't anywhere near as high as it should be, but it's
for recruits, that they are doing certain things. You mentioned the one of the tasks were the training, you can use a treadmill now, you can try to actually do it. So we are actually progressing in terms of trying to get female firefighters who are actually going out to sports clubs, for example. It's hard to actually be politically correct in many ways, but you know what I'm getting at. So there are females who are fit and you can do the job anyway. So we perhaps haven't thought of actually the skills that we have, for example, certain fitness skills and stuff like that, which are a big part of a firefighter's job.
Perhaps
that we are going to, we are actually going to get these people going to safe places, gyms. Falling down on
we fall down on that element of it, and our applications are quite high, but we did still have 40% of female applicants maybe fall out at this stage, so that's where we focused on it. We looked long and hard at the test and decided that there was a potential risk to that in relation to just the size. Yes, we're trying to attract by making the fire service a complete package of an opportunity. But at the same time, we are going to sports clubs, we've gone through the local, the Wirral and Liverpool District Women Football Associations, we're getting stuff into there, social media, running clubs, just trying to utilise every conceivable target. We've got to be more aware in schools. And now the team being bigger into schools as well. But it is around, actually, it's a bit chasing down, it's not meant to be, but there is so much out there that we do have to chase to get into. And we've got to try and make sure that people want to see this as a great place to work and a career and bring people from that way. So the positive action team is certainly for the next 12 months we'll be going out to do far more work than we've been into now. Restrictions of COVID have gone. Try and lay the ground rules, bring in those applicants in. It's the same with universities and colleges are doing those as well, trying to make sure that this is a career opportunity for us.
I appreciate that. I think that the main point is that I'm starting, I'm certainly not speaking for the whole committee, is that we want everybody, whether they're man, woman, trans, whatever they are, to fulfil their potential. And for us to give them the actual chance to do that. Okay. Are you the question?
Yes.
Yeah, I've got a couple of questions, but
sure.
I'd like you to answer them now.
Okay.
But it might be useful if you've got some data back.
Yes.
And the first one is around the accredited development scheme. So what's the proportion of that in terms of protected by the districts?
Accelerated development scheme.
Sorry, accelerated. Yeah. And then the appraisal system. How do you identify? And in terms of identifying the future leaders, do you think that they can afford to protect the sector? And then the coaching and management and the peer mentorship. How is the peer mentorship made up? Because we know that there's an awful lot to be gained from using mentors on a cross section of the community. Because everybody in parts of the nation is different, and sometimes it's lost its identity. And then I think in terms of the peer group, the staff network, for me it's really important that we create safe spaces with staff network, because they're not just, they should be seen as something other than the normal sort of forums where you bring staff together. Because it's also about making sure that it's a safe space for people to feel comfortable when raising issues that, difficult issue. And so there has to be an environment that's real and open Absorb everything.